Alhamdulillah, as usual, inshallah, we're going to open with Quran recitation. Inshallah, and I will be opening it since the brothers are not here. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم تلك الرسل فضلنا بعضهم على بعض منهم من كلم الله ورفع بعضهم درجات وآتينا عيسى ابن مريم البينات وأيدناه بروح القدس ولو شاء الله ما اقتتل الذين من بعدهم من بعد ما جاءتهم البينات ولكن اختلفوا فمنهم من آمن ومنهم من كفر ولو شاء الله ما اقتتلوا ولكن الله يفعل ما يريد يا أيها الذين آمنوا أنفقوا مما رزقناكم من قبل أن يأتي يوم لا بيع فيه ولا خلة ولا شفاعة والكافرون هم الظالمون الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض من ذا الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذنه يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض ولا يؤوده حفظهما وهو العلي العظيم لا إكراه في الدين قد تبين الرشد من الغي فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى لا انفصام لها والله سميع عليم الله ولي الذين آمنوا يخرجهم من الظلمات إلى النور والذين كفروا أولياؤهم الطاغوت يخرجونهم من النور إلى الظلمات أولئك أصحاب النار هم فيها خالدون Can I have a water? Yeah. We're ready for the halaqa? Inshallah. Okay, I think it's good enough. Alhamdulillah, ya Rabbil Alameen. والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله. Is Mustafa interfering with you? Okay. أما بعد إن شاء الله. As usual, we're going to start our حلقة, our Friday حلقة. In last حلقة, we have spoken about the تواضع and the character of being humble, so that the Muslims should have such a character in general. And especially for the طلاب العلم, we have mentioned that the people who are seeking knowledge, those who want to learn something, those who want to learn about their religion, they should be humble, they should have this character. And we spoke about the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and how he was متواضع, how he was humble, and what the Salaf and the Salih, what the people before us, the first Qarn and the second Qarn, do when it comes to the تواضع. So inshallah, today I will be speaking about the thing that can nullify your tawadu', the thing that can take it away your tawadu', the opposite of tawadu', which is arrogance. Before I move to that, inshallah, I wanted to mention one side note of one of the brothers reminded me to mention it, which is that being mutawadu', being humble, does not mean you're weak. It doesn't mean that you let it go, every wrong thing goes around. The Muslim always is firm when it comes to the right and wrong, is firm. But he does not cross the limit that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given it. That's number one. Number two, he does not show superiority against his brother, against somebody else. You don't show with that. But you are humble to yourself on the side of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So being humble does not mean being weak. So inshallah, we have to differentiate between that. We're going to speak about the disease of pride. People being pride and being arrogant. This is one of the diseases that gets into the heart. One of the main disease, one of the worst disease of the heart is the person, so you can see me, right? So that the person being arrogant is one of the main disease of the heart. The Prophet ﷺ described what is kibr, what is arrogant. He said, al-kibru batru al-haq. The arrogance is to deny the truth. When the truth is presented to you, when you are told about Allah and His Messenger, you refuse it. Because this does not fit your hawa, your desire, what you love, what your goals does not fit this. Whenever you are given the truth, you refuse it. It says, بطر الحق, to refuse the truth. Some of the Salaf, they said, تواضع is to accept the truth, even if it comes from a little kid, like a bear. If somebody tells you the truth, it doesn't matter who that person, you accept the truth from that person, that's what it means, تواضع. Prophet ﷺ said, الكبر بطر الحق. Kibr, arrogance, or pride is to deny the truth. وَغَمْضُ النَّاسِ Prophet ﷺ, he said, to look down to the people, to humiliate the people. When you think that you are better than the people, then they know that you have an arrogance, the kibr. You have an arrogance, which is kibr, which the Muslims should not have. Because when you're looking down into the people, you are thinking you are better than the people, you think you are superior than the people, then is the second type of the Qibla that we should avoid. Because generally the believers, the Muslims are brothers. They love each other. They love what you love by yourself, you love to your brother. So you will never expect that. Even if you think you are better, you know better than the brother, still you do not give a tazkiyah to yourself. Allah says, فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Do not purify yourself. Do not ever think that you are better than the others, because هو أعلم بمن يتقى. التقوى is something in the heart. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only knows. You do not know whether that person have more taqwa of you than you. So that's why you always humble. So in short form, al-kibr is batru al-haq, to refuse the truth. To refuse the truth, وَغَمْضُ النَّاسِ, to look down to the people, that's kibr. So inshallah, I'm going to mention some of the realities of the kibr. First and foremost, know that my brothers in Islam, kibr is أَوَّلُ مَعْصِيَةٍ عُصِيَ اللَّهَ بِهَا. Ma'asiyah, the first disobedience that happened on this earth against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the kibr, is the arrogance. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the human being and perfected their creation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the angels to prostrate. This type of prostration was sujudu shukr. It was not sujudu ibad. It was just like showing the importance of the human being to show, to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam. All Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَسَجَدَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the entire angels, they prostrated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ أَبَى وَاسْتَكْبَرْ. Iblis, he refused. He showed arrogance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is the creator. The one who's created him commanded him to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam because of the arrogance that he had. He refused. Allah says in another ayah, وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ أَبَى وَاسْتَكْبَرْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we have commanded to malaika, the angels of Allah. We said, Allah, we have commanded the angels to prostrate to Adam. فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ. They, all of them may sujood to Adam alayhi salam except Iblis. لِمَاذَا أَبَى. He refused. وَاسْتَكْبَرْ. And he became arrogant. So if you look at the nature of the sin that Iblis alayhi la'natullah committed, and if you look at the sin that Adam alayhi salam committed, the nature are different. This was a desire. He just followed his desire. Adam alayhi salam just followed his desire, and Allah told him not to eat from the tree, and he ate from that tree. Then Adam alayhi salam, when he repented and when he went back to Allah, Allah had accepted from him. But Iblis la'natullahi alayhi, he commit an arrogance. When Allah told him to prostrate to Adam, he refused because of arrogance. So Allah forgave Adam when he repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah cursed Iblis with a la'na because when he showed arrogance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this shows that the severeness, the badness of arrogance. With arrogance, my brothers and sisters, a lot of people refuse the haqq. That مثلا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the Yahud, the Jews, those who were at the time of Muhammad, الَّذِينَ آتَيْنَاهُمُ الْكِتَابَ يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاهُمْ. Those whom Allah had given them the book, which was the Jews at the time, Allah says they knew this book. They knew Islam was the truth, that the way they know their own fathers, but they still denied because of the arrogance, because they thought that if another prophet had to come, he has to be from the Jews. They denied, although they knew that the Prophet ﷺ had the symbols that it was mentioned in their books. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, he was Ra's al-Munafiqeen. He denied the truth. He knew that Islam was the truth. He knew the Prophet ﷺ was the truth and his message was true. There's a lot of maqulat, a lot of saying that was reported from Abdullah ibn Salul, that recognizing the truth from the Prophet ﷺ, but he did not believe. Rather, he stayed being a munafiq. Why? Because he had an arrogance in his heart. Because he was supposed to be the leader of Medina before the Prophet ﷺ came. They were about to elect him, to choose him as the leader. But when the Prophet ﷺ came, the people went around the Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ became the leader. So because of the arrogance that he had against that issue, he refused to accept. Even Abu Jahl, there is a maqula, it was reported from him, Abu Jahl, that he said that the Banu Hashim, which is the family of the Prophet ﷺ, they took everything, they take care of the Hujjaj, they do everything in Mecca, and now we're going to give them the prophethood. And he said that, I know that Prophet ﷺ, Muhammad ﷺ is saying the truth, but I cannot give prophethood to him because I don't think they should have it. What they said, the people of Mecca, لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ عَلَى رَجُلٍ مِنَ الْقَرْيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٍ. They said, we wish that this Qur'an was revealed upon somebody who is known with these two cities, Taif and Mecca. So they knew Prophet ﷺ, but they refused the Islam because of the arrogance that they have. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَنَّهُمْ كَانُوا إِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. The people of hellfire, one of their description is that when you tell them, say, لا إله إلا الله, or somebody says to them, لا إله إلا الله, there's no good about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they show arrogance, they have this arrogance in their heart. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throw them into the hellfire. إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا إِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. The story of Sulaiman, again another example of the kibr, is that the story of Sulaiman, when he was calling and giving a da'wah to Balqis, he said, أَلَّا تَعْلُوا عَلَيْهِ. Do not show arrogance against me. وَأْتُونِي مُسْلِمِينَ. Come submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So kibr is the first sin. Again, come back to the point, is that the first thing that was committed in this earth and disobedience that against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second point, the second reality of kibr is that kibr is a reason that divisions happens. There is a lot of khilafat, there is a lot of hate on this earth. Many of these of arrogance, somebody is right and the other person is, he does not want to accept the truth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَمَا اخْتَلَفُوا إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَهُمُ الْعِلْمُ بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ. They did not have a khilaf, except when the truth comes to them, they refused. The refusion that they had given, it led them to have khilafat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the Yahud again in the Quran about their arrogance. He said, أَفَكُلَّمَا جَاءَهُمْ رَسُولٌ حَبِيبِي أَفَكُلَّمَا جَاءَهُمْ رَسُولٌ بِمَا لَا تَهْوَى أَنفُسُهُمْ. Whenever a messenger comes to them, when he tells them something that their heart does not like, استكبروا, they show arrogance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described, this arrogance is, I'm trying to prove that arrogance is the descriptions of the disbelievers. It's not a character of a Muslim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he was describing the munafiqeen, the character of munafiqeen, he said, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ تَعَالَوْا يَسْتَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ لَوَّوْا رُؤُوسَهُمْ وَرَأَيْتَهُمْ يَصُدُّونَ وَهُمْ مُسْتَكْبِرُونَ. When somebody tells them, come to Allah and His Messenger, let the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam ask forgiveness to Allah, that Allah forgives you, لَوَّوْا رُؤُوسَهُمْ, they turn away their heads. And you see them, وَرَأَيْتَهُمْ يَصُدُّونَ, they turn back, وَهُمْ مُسْتَكْبِرُونَ, while they're showing kibr and arrogance. So arrogance is the reason that people have a firqa and ikhtinafat. The third point of the reality of kibr is that a reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed the umam before us, the nations before us, when they showed arrogance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah did not tolerate that. When the people commit sin against Allah, Allah gives them chance. But when you show arrogance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is a major sin to Allah. Allah cannot tolerate that. We're going to see the hadith al-kibiya uridai wal-azamatu izari. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in hadith Qudsi. So this is a reason that Allah destroyed the umam before. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the people Nuh. وَاسْتَغْشَوْ ثِيَابَهُمْ وَأَصَرُّوا وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا اسْتِكْبَارًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they cover themselves with a cloth. With a cloth, and وَأَصَرُّوا, and they sowed israr, refusion against the messenger of Nuh alayhi salam. وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا اسْتِكْبَارًا, they show arrogance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah spoke about Fir'aun and his army, Allah says, وَاسْتَكْبَرَ هُوَ وَجُنُودُهُ فِي الْأَرْضِ. When they showed arrogance, him and his junood in this earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَخَذْنَاهُ وَجُنُودَهُ فَنَبَذْنَاهُمْ فِي الْيَمِّ وَهُوَ مَلِيمٌ. When they showed arrogance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah destroyed them. Allah threw them into the oceans because of them showing arrogance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you look at the qawm of Hud, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَمَّا عَادٌ فَاسْتَكْبَرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ. If you look at the Aad, they show arrogance on this earth. They show so pride in this earth. فَاسْتَكْبَرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ بِغَيْرِ. They said, وَقَالُوا مَنْ أَشَدُّ مِنَّا قُوَّةً. Allah had given them a power. They said, who is powerful other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Then Allah showed them their arrogance. So those whom showed arrogance to Allah, Allah had put halak into them. Allah destroyed them. Allah says, أَوَلَمْ يَرُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ الَّذِي خَلَقَهُمْ أَشَدُّ مِنْ قُوَّةً. And all the umam, all the nations that Allah destroyed them, all of them, this was a couple of examples, all of them had shown arrogance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we're going to learn that arrogance is a major sin, a sin that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not tolerate for. Allah cannot tolerate for that. So inshallah, I'm going to mention what causes the arrogance, some of the reasons that people show arrogance. Number one, sometimes people show arrogance because of a wealth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given them. They do not look into the matter that this wealth that Allah had given them is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's wealth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in numerous places in the Quran, the wealth Allah says is the wealth of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah had entrusted them. What was the ayah saying in وَمَا لَكُمْ أَلَّا تُنْفِقُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلِلَّهِ مِيرَاجُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَا يَسْتَوِي مِنْكُمْ مَنْ أَنْفَقَ مِنْ قَبْلِ الْفَتْحِ وَقَاتَلَ. The ayah before, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the wealth, the money, is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had entrusted you. So if Allah had given you a wealth, you should avoid a reason of showing arrogance. Rather, you should be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by giving the wealth that Allah had trusted you in. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given you this wealth for a test, so Allah sees how you're gonna react, whether you're gonna give it for the sake of Allah, or whether you're gonna be humble with it, or you're gonna be arrogant as a Haman, the wazir of Fir'aun, when they showed arrogance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him a wolf. Allah says the story of Qarun. He said, قَالَ إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. This wolf that Allah had given him, he was so rich. He said that إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given me this wealth because of a knowledge that I have. Because of a knowledge that I have. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had destroyed him. So people usually, and sometimes, they show wealth. They show arrogance because of wealth that Allah had given you. This is not a general rule. You will see a lot of people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given them a wealth. But they are grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They give the money whomever they can support. They don't show superiority against the people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give them a wealth. The second cause that people always show arrogance is the knowledge. And this is the worst type of arrogance, of pride. Because the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given you should be a reason that you humble yourself. If your knowledge did not help you, then you're going to show arrogance. So that's why this is the worst type of arrogance. Whoever seeks a knowledge because he wants a fakhr, because he wants people to praise him, because he want to get a position, you seek a knowledge for that reason, then you're going to have the arrogance. But yeah, if you seek the knowledge for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you will never have an arrogance. Know that, my brothers in Islam, if you have an atom weight of arrogance in your heart, you will not enter Jannah. This is a reason that can stop you from Jannah. When you think you are better, you are good, and nobody can catch up with you, and you are superior, and everyone is wrong, and you are the only one right, then you will not able to get the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes people may be arrogant because of a lineage. Because he's from that country, because he's from that family, his family is well known. This reason, mainly in back home, alhamdulillah, the country that we are in, still exists the racism, but people are not as of the back home, and we should be very honest on that. We're not saying that the religion in this country is good or anything like that, but that's normal, because they have been having a bad history with racism, and that they're trying not to show, at least. But in our country, people do not get married to each other because of a lineage. They think that this lineage is better than that lineage. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ اتقاكم. The best of you, the best amongst you are those who have a taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if Allah had given you a good lineage, maybe you're the good family, maybe you could be even from the family of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this should not give you superiority over the others. Rather, you should humble yourself and you should not be arrogant, and know that nasab is not going to survive in the hereafter. Your lineage will not survive you. If you do not come good deeds in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will not gain the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And trust me, my brothers in Islam, there are some people who think back home. I was telling one of the brothers earlier, we were just talking, when some people, they think that because they are from family so and so, they will not go to hellfire. Trust me, I heard in my ears from the elders, they think that they're from that family, they are they're from the family of Prophet ﷺ. They say even our disobedient, this is the way they say literally, they say even our disobedient person will not get into the fire, into the fire. That is arrogance against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your lineage should never lead you to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fourth cause is usually people show arrogance or show pride is because Allah had given them a position or a leadership position. They are in charge of something, or they are, alhamdulillah, they have a good job, they are in good position. They show arrogance. Maybe they are doctors, they are lawyers. They show arrogance against the people. When they come to the masjid, you try to shake their hands. Some of them, even they will not shake your hands good. And my brothers and sisters, one point I want to make it really make sure that what I'm mentioning is something that you should look in to yourself. I'm not expecting anything that I mentioned in the halaqah that, hey, that person, somebody comes into your mind. You say, yeah, Imam, somebody like that. You shouldn't think about somebody else. This is something that you should check from yourself. You should check your own. And again, kibr is the amal in heart, is the action that happens in the heart. Nobody knows other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you should not make a judgment on a person that he has a kibr. When you're making judgment on the person he has a kibr, what you're saying, that person will not go to Jannah, right? Because the person who have a kibr will not get into Jannah. So you shouldn't make any judgment. So sometimes people, they have a leadership position, then they're going to show arrogance. They think that they are better than the other people. This is not something good. And they wish that the people, when he comes in, they want people to stand up for them, to say salam to them, or to show to show it's okay to get up for a person to hug him, مثلاً. You can, somebody whom you know, مثلاً, Yasin came, you didn't see him for a while, you stand up so you can give him a hug. There's no problem. But if the person who is people standing up for him, if he thinks that he earned this position because he's so and so, then that's the type of the arrogance. This hadith in Tirmidhi, Jami' Sahih Tirmidhi, it was narrated by Abi Majlisin. He said, "Kharaja Muawiyah." Muawiyah came at the time he was the Amir. He came in, he came out. Abdullah ibn Zubayr and ibn Safwan stood up when they see him. They might be getting up so just they could give him a hug, or there could be any other reasons. Then he said, "Anas and Abi Majlis." I mean, he said to them, "Sit down, because I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that man sarrahu an yatamathal lahu ar-rijalu qiyaman falyatabawwa maq'adahu min an-nar." Whoever wants the people to get up for him when they come to show like he's somebody big or something like that, that he prepare for his place in the hereafter. So if you expect the people to get up for you, and when the people did not get up for you, you feel like, man, this guy does not respect me at all, then know that you have an arrogant, and that quality will never get you into Jannah, rather it's going to throw you to the hellfire. So inshallah, I'm going to give you again some of the characters of the arrogant people. So this is something that you look into yourself, not to make a judgment on others. Number one is al-uluwu anil haqq. He always thinks he's above the truth. Whatever he says, he thinks that's the truth one. And he looks down into the people who are lower than him in a position, مثلاً, in a knowledge. This is the first way that you're gonna know and you have arrogance in your heart. So if you always try to get it. Some people, they might look into the مثلا, a mas'ala. So a mas'ala, they want to check what the Islam says about it. They will see a lot of aqwal. مثلا, they may Google it, or they may go to a sheikh. When he sees something that opposite that what he wants, he just, again, he goes Google again, the next page. Maybe I'm going to find my desire. He's looking at an answer that is already ready for it. That's the type of arrogance. If you have given a proof, the truth right in front of your face, and you have told قال الله قال رسول الله وإذا قيل لهم تعالوا إلى ما أنزل الله إلى الرسول, if you have been told this is what Allah and messengers had told you, submit yourself to it. Munafiqeen, what they do? They refuse. They look for excuse. They will always say, there's any other qawl in this matter, they're not going to submit to the truth. That's type of the arrogance that people should not have it. And know again, my brothers in Islam, the arrogance is the pride. I don't want to translate into arrogance. The pride is one of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He's the creator, He's the powerful, so he can have that pride because He have done so much and He deserves to be pride of Himself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of the many favors that He have do for His creations. So Prophet ﷺ, he said in a hadith of Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this hadith, a hadith of Qudsi, He says, Al-Izzu Izari. He said, Al-Izz, which is pride, is my clock. Al-Izzu Izari. Wal-Kibriya'u Rida'i. Allah says, the Kibriya, being pride or greatness, is my rope, is the rope that I have. He said, Faman yunaza'ani adabtu. Whoever argues with me, whoever competes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this quality, he will be thrown into hellfire. Another narration says, Al-Kibriya'u Izari wal-Azamat Rida'i, faman naza'ani minhuma qadaftuhu fil-nar. I will throw him to the hellfire. So you are, when you're showing arrogance to the creations of Allah, then you're taking one of the attributes of Allah. That's why Allah will not tolerate that. Allah will throw you into the hellfire if you have that. You always watch out yourself. Do not fall yourself into the arrogance. And arrogance also, my brothers and sisters, the reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can punish you in this world before hereafter, even when you drag your clothes down because of arrogance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will throw you to hellfire. There's a hadith of Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. He said, Baynama rajul, وسلم, he spoke about a man. He said, Baynama rajulun yajurru izarahu min al-khuyala khusifa bihi. While one of the men from the previous people, he was dragging his clothes because of arrogance, because he wanted to show superior. He was walking arrogantly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala khusifa bihi al-ard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cut the earth on him. He went down. And until the day of judgment, he'll keep going down to the earth, because subhanahu wa ta'ala Allah had cut the earth on him. Did I say it right? Cut the earth. The earth swallowed him. He keep going down until the day of judgment, until he reaches the peak. So know that the kibriya is the alam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if you argue with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that, he will throw you to hellfire. So the first character of the mutakabbir is that he always denies the truth and he humiliates the people below him. The second character of a mutakabbir, of the arrogant person, is that he always have this jealousy against his colleagues. He always feel bad when somebody who is the same, مثلاً, somebody you are the same student, مثلاً, your colleagues, you always feel bad when somebody gets something good. It hurts you. You see somebody who are the same colleagues of you, mashallah, he's good, or مثلاً, he answers a question. مثلاً, the Imam asked a question, and one of the brothers answered, then Imam, mashallah, congratulated the brother. Then the person who has a hasad, jealousy in his heart, it hurts him that. He said, he feels bad in his heart. He does not show it, but he has it in his heart. Then just know that that person have a kibr, because you think that you're superior than that person. It can be in any level. Somebody, normally you see the people, mashallah, now they're looking up to him, they're respecting him. Then that is taking you away from saying the truth and congratulating and being happy for the brother. Then you have arrogant in your heart, then there's a problem, you have a kibr. Sometimes it could happen, somebody who is مثلاً your cousin, usually this way it happens, somebody who's from your family members, mashallah, he graduated good with the school, mashallah, now he's getting to, maybe he's becoming a doctor, then you feel bad. You feel bad. You don't want him to have that. You don't want to have it to have bad. Then that's the arrogant that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not appreciate or tolerate, and you will miss the jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of that reason. The third one. The third character of mutakabbir is that he looks down into the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he sees the person who follows the sunnah, he looks down into them. He sees a person, mashallah, brother, who have a long beard, he says, man, and the Daesh, man, you are a Daesh, what's wrong with you? Or he humiliates, he makes fun of the person. He sees somebody who holds his pants a little bit longer, he sees it, he mocks on him. This is at least, it's the sunnah of Prophet to keep the beard. We're not going to talk about the mas'ala, we can break it down in another class. But overall, you mock onto that person. You see somebody who has a growing beard, hey, are you getting Daesh? You're mocking on that person. Then you should know that this is a sign, a symbol of arrogance against Allah and against His Sunnah. This is very sin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the munafiqeen when they made fun of the companions of Prophet sallam. Give me a second. Allah says, وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ, when you ask them about munafiqeen, why did you do that? Why did you say that? لَيَقُولُنَّ إِنَّمَا كُنَّا نَخُضُ وَنَلْعَبُ, we're just playing, I was just joking. If somebody, you see him, somebody who's making fun of somebody who's doing a sunnah, tell him, you can't do, brother, that. This is sunnah. You cannot make fun of the sunnah of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, man, I'm joking. I'm not serious. I'm just saying it. The munafiqeen say the same excuses. Allah says, لَيَقُولُنَّ إِنَّمَا كُنَّا نَخُضُ وَنَلْعَبُ, they will say, we're just having fun. We're just playing. It was not serious, man. قُلْ أَبِ اللَّهِ, Allah says, قُلْ أَبِ اللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ وَرَسُولِهِ كُنْتُمْ تَزَّعْزِئُونَ, are you guys going to make fun upon Allah's ayat, the ayat of Allah and His Messenger and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you going to make fun on that? قُلْ أَبِ اللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, Allah and His Messenger and His ayat, you going to make fun of them? Allah says, لَا تَعْتَذِرُوا, do not give excuses. Do not give an excuse. Allah says, قَدْ كَفَرْتُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ, after you believed, you're committing a kufr, you're doing act of disbelief of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're leaving the folder of Islam when you make fun of the sunnah of Prophet. It could be a reason, it could be digged, it could be ajal, it could be that and that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the act that the munafiqeen done, لا تعتذروا, do not give an excuse. Indeed, this is a kufr after you have believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know that بعد إيمانكم, Allah said, after you had an iman. So it shows that also they had an iman, that those people who said that, they had iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but because of that and a comment that they made, they left the folder of Islam. So it's not fun, my brothers in Islam, to mock on the people when they do the sunnah of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to mock on somebody who's doing something khair, something represented Islam, something Ahlus Sunnah, to mark on them, that's not something easy in Islam and could put you in a lot of trouble. It could put you a lot of trouble. It might even take you out of the folder of Islam. There is hadith of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ayas ibn Salim ibn al-Aqwa, he says that his father had told him this hadith, that a man came to the Prophet sallam and he was eating in the presence of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his left hand. The Prophet sallam, he said, Kul bi yaminik. He said, eat with your right hand. This man, he just wanted to show some arrogance. He says, no, I cannot eat with my hand. Because Allah Prophet sallam, he told him what to do in Islam. He said, La astatir, I cannot do it. Then lastata'at, he said, may you not be able to do it. Nothing stopped him except a kibr. And that person could not move his hands up from that, it became paralyzed. He could not eat with his hand and with his hand anymore because of him showing arrogance and making fun when especially the Prophet ﷺ had told him in front of him. Another symbol, another sign of kibr is that you follow your desires. You always look what satisfies you. You always look into the life that you live into it. Is anything fits your way of life, you take it. Anything that does not fit your way of life, you refuse it, you reject it. Then that is a show, that's a sign of arrogance. When the people tells you Allah and His Messenger says, it's hadith, clear cut, no debate on this issue, that's what Allah and His Messenger says, you don't want to take it because it does not fit your desire. So this also is a symbol of kibr, and Allah will seal the heart of the person who has the kibr. Allah says, كَذَلِكَ يَطُبَعُ اللَّهُ على قلبي متكبر جبار. Allah will seal the heart of the person who shows arrogance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another symbol of arrogance, another sign, another character of the arrogant person is that he thinks of himself so good. He's so proud of himself. Whenever you see that person, he always speaks about his accomplished. MashaAllah, if he's a teacher, he always talks about the classes that he do, how many people attend, how people are impressed with him, and his past jobs. I have done that, and I have done that, and I have done that. And if it's about the accomplishments in life, it's okay. If it's something that you did it for Allah, you should not mention, unless there is a good reason to mention it, and you do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one of the type of the person having this arrogant in his heart is that he mentions himself. He mentions himself. When people mention how good he has done, he says, man, I got this. I know nobody better than me. Rather, the best way to respond when you do somebody something good, مثلاً, you did something good for the community, people come to you, say, Jazakallahu khair. The best way is, may Allah accept from us. You should worry about the acceptance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Somebody comes to you, tells you, mashallah, the khutbah was really good. What do you say, mashallah, I know how to do it, man. I'm the best of this matter. Now, the best way is you to worry, not his comment, to worry about whether Allah accepted or not. So the person who thinks so good of himself, he thinks that nobody is better than that person, then know that that's an act of arrogance in your heart. It's something that very, very huge in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So sometimes, some people, they have this character in their heart, the character of thinking of self, assuming himself very, very good, and they're better than everyone else. They think that they are much better than anybody else, but they show otherwise. They show otherwise, which is they have this in their heart, but they don't want to admit it. They act humble, which when they are not, when they know all the way in their heart, they're the best people, and they, mashallah, they're good, and they act over that. So this is also delusion of shaitan. You should be careful with that. What matters is not what you do. What matters is what is in your heart. And nobody else knows other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you know that you have this attribute, character in your heart, get rid of it. From your heart, not from your actions. When the heart gets rid of it, the actions will appear and people will see you that way. So you should be worried about it. There is a book called Talbis Iblis, The Delusions of the Devil. Who heard about that book? Who wrote it? Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawzi, na'am, jazakallah khair. Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawzi wrote that. You should read that. It helps, it really helps your heart, good. It clears your heart. If you read it from your heart, it's gonna clear you. So I'm gonna suggest for everybody to check that or check some chapters, look into the table of the contents. If you Google it, you'll find in Arabic. I hope English is there too. Bilal Phillips made it. So inshallah, look into that book. It helps you with your heart, especially about the matters. So because sometimes shaitan plays with you. He might tell you to show something that you're not in your heart, so you can get rid of it. Still, it doesn't mean that you should show arrogance, but still you can get rid of that. That's the sixth character of the person who have arrogance. The seventh one is that التَّرَفُعُ فِي الْمَجَالِسِ وَالتَّقَدُّمُ عَلَى الْأَقْرَانِ. In the gatherings, you want to be better. When the people sitting in a place, you're not happy to sit in the back because you think you're not going to be somebody good. Or people sitting in the chairs, you like to sit VIP, always seats. You think of yourselves VIP. When people are sitting, people tell you this is VIP, this is that, they do in this country. You always look up to yourself into a VIP. You think you are a very good, very important person. This is also a sign of arrogance. And always you want to beat your colleagues. All your goals is okay to want it, and everybody want it to be the best in the class, the best student in class. But your goal, you come the entire halaqa to just to beat somebody, to show somebody you can beat him. You can answer the questions. Yes, if there is a question is asked, you have to answer, and you are expected, and the teacher is expecting you will answer, and you shouldn't hide it. It's good to answer the questions. There is Umar and Abdullah ibn Umar, they were together at a time, and he asked, and Umar ibn Khattab asked a question. It was about the Prophet asked that question. The Prophet asked that question. What was the question?
What's
the
tree that resembles a believer?
Yes, that's one. Also, there's another incident that I want to mention too. The incident that I'm trying to mention is that when Umar was with him and asked him about, it was actually Abdullah ibn Abbas, I'm not sure. It's Ibn Abbas, yes. He asked a question and he did not answer it until the end. And Umar lately said it, that he wished he would answer. Another, the closest one could be example, is that when they were Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asking about a tree, which was about the palm tree, but he did not answer. He said, I would love to you to answer. I would love everything, before anything, you to answer this question. So it's okay to answer the questions, but your goal, your hadaf, the entire reason that you come for the class, for the halaqa, should not be that answer. That is a wasila, rather it's not a goal. There's not a goal, it's just a way it's going to come through you. Allah says, وَخْفِضْ جَنَاحَكَ لِمَنِ اتَّبَعَكَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Lower your wings, show humbleness, humility to the believers. One of the sifat of mutakabbir, arrogance, is that, especially the people who are a little bit, they have some positions, or they are some leaders in some way, they don't, because of arrogance, when they go, they want to take a group with them. And they want to show to the crowd, especially the people of the Muslim, you see them, because of arrogance, whenever they come to a meeting, they bring 10 people with them. It's okay to have company with you, and I like taking companies. Whenever I want to go to another masjid, I love to take the brothers, because I love their companies. But you see, like some of the presidents, like Mathalan, it was mentioned, like the president of Egypt, he had 3 miles of red carpet. He put himself and his people starving for food. He put 3 miles red carpet just to walk on arrogance, and he brought all his hashia with him, all his group with him, so that he shows the people that he's so strong, he's so powerful person. So this is one of the symbols, one of the signs that the person shows that he has some ghulu, some ghurur in his heart. Okay. Another character, another symbol shows that you might have some arrogance in your heart is that you think that people owes you. It means like when you're sick, you want people all to come and visit you. But when it comes to your side, you don't go to nobody. Especially when somebody who's sick and poor, you don't want to go to his sickness, to his place. Or somebody have methylene weddings. If the rich people invites you, you're there. You're gonna go. You're gonna make the time and go. When a brother, normal person invites you, you have all excuses. When there is an event, normally somebody invites you to that event, it's very mutawadir. Maybe you're invited in a mosque, which is a very humble mosque, or you're invited to speak in there, you don't accept it. When you are invited into the conventions and all of that, you go. You go to show power yourself. This shows that you have arrogance in your heart and you should get rid of it. These are some of the character of the people, the person who have arrogance. Now let's talk about the dawa, because you might find yourself, you have one of this character. What is dawa? How are you gonna cure your heart from having arrogance. First, remember the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given you favors. So you cannot turn that favor that Allah had given you against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the reason that your arrogance is a man, is a wealth, this is a ni'mah of Allah, and you should be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the reason that you're showing arrogance is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given you knowledge, then you're using that against Allah. You should be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He had given you this ni'mah, and you should praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the best way to do shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to act upon it. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted the Prophet sallam the forgiveness, لِيَغْفَرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمْ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ, Allah forgiven his sins, he was grateful to Allah. He did not sit down there and said, Alhamdulillah, shukrillah only. Rather, he did it into actions. He prayed all night until his feet cracked. Aisha, when she asked him, he said, why did you do this, O Prophet of Allah? Allah had forgiven you the entire your sins, the past and the future ones, and Allah had granted you al-maqam al-mahmud. Why you do all this? He said that, أَفَلَا أَكُونَ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا, wouldn't I be a grateful servant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So when you're showing arrogance, remember the ni'mah of Allah. This is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You should be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Example, you wouldn't do this as a creation of Allah. If I would give you money, مثلا, I'm the one who give you good money, you would not show arrogance against me because I had given it to you. So what about the creator, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى, if Allah had given you, you should never show it in your heart, anything about that. The second cure for the arrogance and kibr is that imitate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If somebody could make a lot of money, is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He could make a lot of wealth. He could be the richest person. If somebody, because of a power, would show arrogance, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is so powerful, but he was rather opposite of that. He was very mutawadi'. So follow, imitate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and follow his footsteps. Remember the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to pass by the children, he used to say salam to them. Sometimes the amma, a female slave, would take the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and she wants the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to do something for her, he would do for her. So follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, remember the sunnah of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When it comes to the amal and the battle of Khandaq, as we mentioned in last class, he was the one who was doing it in his hand. Don't be the bossy, the person who actually tells, hey, I need somebody to do that and that, I need volunteers to do that and that. Rather humble yourself and do not show arrogance and be part of the things. And also do not show arrogance on the knowledge. This is the worst type of the arrogance. Be like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Follow his footsteps. One time, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in this hadith, he was making a khutbah. A man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was a gharib man. He was a stranger man. Nobody knew that man. He said, "Rajulun gharibun jaa yasalu an dini." This is a strange man. I'm asking about my religion. I want to know about my religion. لا يدري ما دينه, I do not know what's my religion. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned into him and he stopped his khutbah, and even he get a kursi, a chair that we can teach that person, and he started teaching him until he was done. Then he went back and completed his khutbah. So if you are somebody whom Allah had given you a knowledge, do not show arrogance. Let that knowledge be shared with others. Teach the people who needs to know. Teach the people who knows to know in the salawat, مثلا. In this masjid, we have a lot of people who are newly converted Islam. Take a time, even ask them, hey, do you know everything about the salah? Sometimes I ask them because the people are not doing it. You guys should, especially some minor things like the salat. This is, you guys should do it. Should do it and teach them how to pray, especially when you know how to pray. Share that with the people. Let them know about the basic thing of their Islam. So be concerned about them. Ask them. It's not something wrong. It's not arrogance when you ask them, hey, you know exactly how to pray, or you want me to help you? Help him if he needs that help. The third cure for the arrogance is the most important cure is remember al-akhirah. Remember your destiny. Remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would punish you. Allah would not give you a jannah in hereafter. And know that the people of jannah are people of tawadu'. There is hadith of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Sahih Muslim, Abi Sa'id al-Khudri Nari. He says, احتجت الجنة والنار. The Jannah and Nar, they have some debate. Then Jannah said, فِي الْجَبَّارُونَ وَالْمُتَكَبِّرُونَ. In me, he said, in hellfire, he said, I got the people who are jabbarun, arrogant, those who think they're better, those who think they're superior than the others. jannah, he said, فِيَ ضُعَفَاءُ النَّاسِ وَمَسَاكِنِمْ. He said, I will get the people of the weak people. The people always look down to them. People always oppress them. Those will get the jannah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judged between them. He said, إِنَّكِ الْجَنَّةِ. The jannah, he said, رَحْمَتِي أَرْحَمُ بِكِ مَنْ أَشَاءُ. You are my mercy, and I will give my mercy to anybody whom I want. And he spoke, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to the fire. He said, وَأَنْتِ عَذَابِي. You are my punishment, and I will punish with whoever I want. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلِكِلَيْكُمَا عَلَيَّ مِنْ. Both of you, I will fill it. So the Jannah will get full, and Allah would create people for the Jannah, and also the hellfire will get filled by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith shows that Allah would place his feet in the hellfire. How? The way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows, and the way Allah deserves to him. So know that, I'll remember the Akhirah, your ma'al, where you're going to go. And also know your haqiqah, your reality, from the beginning to the middle and to the end. From the beginning, Allah says, min nutfatin khalaq, min ayyi shay'in khalaqa, min nutfatin khalaqahu faqaddara. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you from a nutfah, from a sperm. You're not from something that people, something that you should show pride. Your origin is something like nutfah, from a sperm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. From your middle part, you're going to go to your grave. You're going to be alone. Nobody will be there with you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to question you. Everything that you have done in this life, you're going to see it in front of you in your grave, and Allah would ask you. Your grave will be either garden of Jannah, or it's going to be in a place of hellfire. So remember also your middle. And remember your destiny at the end of Akhirah, that either you're going to go to Jannah or you're going to go to the hellfire. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us a Jannah. The fourth cure for the arrogance is that read about the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You're going to learn how sallallahu alayhi wasallam humbled himself, how humble person he was. Look at the seerah of the Sahaba, the Hayatul Sahaba, and all of that. Look at their lives, how they lived, how humble life they lived. And look at how when they humbled themselves, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevated them to up. So read those seer, read the books of the seerah, read seerah A'lam al-Nubala, Sifatul Safwa, any book that would give you, any authentic book. You might see some other things too. Make sure that it's authentic, read their lives and study and follow their footsteps. The sixth cure is to leave, abandon your hawa, your desires. Just humble yourself to Allah and His Messenger. When you hear Allah and His Messenger said, follow it. Al-Fudayl rahimahullah says, التواضع أن تخضع للحق وتنقاد له. تواضع is to submit yourself to the truth and let the truth guide you. Not you guide the truth. You cannot guide the truth. Do not follow your desire. If you find the truth, follow it. A man came to Malik ibn Maghul. He was one of the Salaf. He said, Ittaqullah, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of us, when people tell us, fear Allah, what do? We fight back. This is the symbol, the character of the munafiqeen. Allah says, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُ اتَّقِ اللَّهِ أَخْذَتُ الْعِزَّةُ بِالْإِثْمِ. When you tell him, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the munafiq, he will have this pride, this izzah in his heart. فَحَزْبُهُ جَهَنَّمُ. Allah says, he's going to go to hellfire. So rather, when somebody tells you, fear Allah, you should humble yourself. Malik ibn Maghlul, he says that when a man came to him and told him, fear Allah, he put his cheek on the ground. It's because he was reminded about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your response should be nice. And finally, and as I mentioned earlier, I'm going to conclude inshallah within a few minutes. And our destiny, remember your goal. Your goal is the Jannah of Allah, a Jannah of arduha as-samawat. Your life is not this life. This life is just temporary life. Your life is the eternal life. As I mentioned last night in the Khatira, the day of judgment is more important than this dunya. Because this dunya, 50, 60 years hereafter, you know the day of judgment, how long is it? How long is the day of judgment? It's 50,000 years. So how are you going to buy with this and this? Even in numbers, the day of judgment is more. So do not let this delusion life and take your mind so that you show arrogance to the people. So remember about Al-Akhirah and know that your goal, as I mentioned, is a Jannah of Allah, to get a Jannah. And in order to get a Jannah, you cannot have a kibr in your heart, arrogance in your heart. Sacrifice that feeling that you have in your heart, that you're superior than the other people, or you think that the feeling that you have in your heart, that you are somebody who got, nobody can touch him. Know that in order you to get a Jannah, you have to clear that. Prophet ﷺ said, لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال ذرة من كبر. A Jannah will not a person will not get a Jannah if you have a massive seed weight in your heart. If you have even a small, an atom weight of arrogance in your heart, you will not enter the Jannah. Allah says, أَلَيْسَ فِي جَهَنَّمَ مَثْوًا لِلْمُتَكَبِّرِينَ Is in Jahannam a mathwa, is a place, a destiny for those who show arrogance? The Prophet ﷺ, he said about his companions, أَلَا أُخْبِرُكُمْ بِأَهْلِ النَّارِ Shall I not tell you about the people of hellfire? Then he said, كُلُّ عُتُلٍ جَوَّاطٍ مُتَكَبِّرٍ Every arrogant, every person who thinks himself superior, denied the haq, arrogance, you're going to be the people of the hellfire. So do not let yourself be fooled by this dunya and the delusions of this dunya so that you show it to others. Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ الدَّاخِرِينَ Those who show arrogance of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will enter to Jannah. أَخِيرًا inshallah. Finally, the sentence that I'm going to close is that know that regardless how much you show arrogance to Allah or to His creations, know that haqq upon Allah is a right upon Allah that He will put you down. He will put you down. You show arrogance in this world, at the end you might have some time that you think yourself you're powerful. At the end, remember that Allah will put you down. There's a hadith of Prophet ﷺ. He said, حَقٌ عَلَى اللَّهِ أَلَّا يَرْتَفِعَ شَيْءٌ مِّنَ الدُّنْيَا A haqq upon Allah, nothing in this dunya and raises up, shows himself superior except إِلَّا وَضَعَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put him down. Regardless of even the governments, this is normal, like the dawlat, when they go so powerful, when they go to the peak, when they show arrogance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah put them down, they're destroyed. That's what happens to the people when they don't show arrogance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now that, what's your goal in this when you show arrogance? The people who do arrogance, they just want to be on the race all the time. They will be the leaders. But at the end, Allah is going to put you down, and know that, remember that, and your destiny and the akhirah is going to be worse on this dunya. So it's nothing that worthy to lose for Jannah. It's nothing that could give you a kibr, especially when you know your background and what you're created from. So it's something that everybody should remember, inshallah. This is also a character that a person who is seeking an Allah should avoid it. A lot of times when we see people who are the same colleagues of us, when we see them, they're doing really good, the people are looking up to them, we feel arrogance, we feel something in our heart that might nullify your deeds. This is, inshallah, last session of the Seeking Knowledge Supplement, inshallah. This is part 6. We could go more and give more advice to the people who are seeking knowledge, but inshallah we're going to stop so that we can go back to the hadith of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and Sahih al-Bukhari. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us those who say and obey whatever they say in their tongues would show in their body parts, inshallah. Wajazakumullahu khayra wa barakallahu feekum. Subhanakallahu wa bihamdik. Shidu la ilaha illa anta nasakhurukum tubi ilayk. Any question? Inshallah we can cut it.